I chose Lego Batman from the Vault because this movie is a great example of how to use resonance to stir emotions in your audience. It also gives me a few good laughs, and I do love this movie a great deal. Now, resonance taps into the power of recapturing or reliving the feelings that we've experienced before. So this is a good thing, especially if they were positive feelings. This movie is also a terrific example of the importance of understanding your genre and your audience. So this is a great episode to refresh your understanding of story structure and resonance. Enjoy.
If you want to write stories your readers will love, there are three things you need to do. Understand storytelling principles, see how other writers have applied those principles, and then use them in your own work. Here on the Story Nerd Podcast, our goal is to demystify story theory. We'll help you with the first two steps so that you can get started with the third. My name is Valerie Francis. I'm a writer and literary editor, and I focus on stories by, for, and about women.
And I'm Melanie Hill, writer, editor, and poet, and I have a passion for spy stories, fairy tales, and master detective novels.
On today's episode, Melanie pitched the Lego Batman movie so that we can study resonance. This 2017 film was directed by Chris McKay from a story by Seth Graham Smith based on Lego construction toys and the DC comic. It's like product placement gone mad. Of course, there will be spoilers because we can't talk about the movie without talking about the movie. But it's Batman. You know what happens. And we'd love it if you could give the show a rating and review. For Apple Podcast listeners, you can do it right from your phone. Simply go to the show's landing page and scroll to the bottom. It really is that simple. All righty, Miss Melanie, what do you have for the genre?
Well, I thought it was pretty simple this week. So we have, for the global genre, I have an action story. And then for the secondary genre, I had a worldview education because of the whole relationship Batman theme that goes through the movie. What did you have?
Exactly the same thing. The global genre is action. Secondary is worldview education because Batman is finding meaning in relationships. Okay. Melanie, based on what you said about resonance last week, I think I know why you chose Lego Batman this season, but why don't you take us through it?
All right. Well, this is a fun movie to watch. I chose the Lego Batman movie because it has so much resonance in it. At times it's a case of too much resonance is not enough, when you see all the characters in the film. But on a serious side, this movie is an excellent example of internal, so thematic resonance, and external, so genre resonance. It's also, I think, an example of how new subgenres are created by using resonance. And by this I mean a Lego movie, and because there's a lot more Lego movies out there over the last 10 or 12 years, and they are starting to create their own conventions, just like Pixar did. And I'll touch on that a little bit later as well and explain and give examples. Now, I promised this week that I'd expand on what resonance is, and so I'm going to go into a little bit of theory. So resonance in writing is not mentioned or discussed in many theory books, and I think this makes it a fascinating topic to understand or at least explore some more. Now, I first came across the idea of resonance in Dave Farland's book called Million Dollar Outlines. And he pointed readers to his other book, Drawing on the Power of Resonance in Writing, which I've also read and I have. And this builds a pretty good case for why writers need to understand what resonance is. And it also analyzes The Lord of the Rings to demonstrate how Tolkien used resonance in that particular trilogy. So what is resonance? Well, last week I gave the following New Oxford American Dictionary definition of resonance, which is the ability to evoke or suggest images, emotions, and memories. So how does it work? Well, resonance is like a refrain is in music. And a refrain is something that it repeats itself throughout a song. So each time something is repeated, the message of the refrain becomes stronger and more significant. In classical music, we often hear the same notes played over and over again at different tempos with different instruments and at different volumes. And so the refrain resonates throughout the piece of music or through pieces of music. This also happens in story. So stories draw from what has gone before. And one story is the basis for another and another and so on. So readers, if they like a particular story, seek out similar stories with the aim of recapturing or reliving the feeling they experienced in the previous novel. Now, our imaginations are not the infinite vessels that we might think they are. They can't necessarily create things out of thin air. Instead, our minds store bits of information that are recycled and mixed in with other information during the creative process. Of course, this is a simplified version of how the brain creates, but the important point to note is that your subconscious draws from the stories that you've read before to create the story that you are writing now, and it comes from somewhere within your mind and your memory. Now, writers may or may not realize that they are doing this because there's a vast library in our head that we use and that we gather throughout our lives. Or, you know, we can sometimes draw from our own experiences or feelings and emotions that we've had. And this is exactly what we're doing when we're writing. We're drawing on that information to create a new story. Now, I'm guessing that if you're a writer, then you're a reader too. And you will have a type of story that you love and some that you don't. So for me, I love a good fairy tale and spy stories, but I don't enjoy horror stories. And I look for the stories that I like and I avoid the stories that I don't like. And I think we all do this. So why do we do it? Well, readers feel powerful emotions when a book resembles previous books that we've read and loved. So readers feel those powerful emotions when a book they're reading resembles their lived experience. And readers feel powerful emotions when they read a story that meets their emotional needs. So this could be escapism, adventure, or love. So here is a quote from page 6 of Drawing on the Power of Resonance in Writing. All successful writers use resonance to enhance their stories by drawing power from stories that came before, by resonating with their readers' experiences, and by resonating with their own works. End quote. Now, Farland proposes that there are three types of resonance. There's genre, life, and emotional needs. Now, genre, and I'm going to use the widest possible definition of genre. And by doing this, I mean the type of story. So this could be, you know, alien love stories or superhero stories. So I'm using a very broad definition there. Then life. So people read and relate to stories that resemble their own life experience, you know, and we can sometimes focus on people of similar age, gender, nationality, and life experience. And then with emotional needs, we often choose a particular type of story because we are seeking to relive a positive emotional experience, but also see ways that maybe the problems that we're facing have been solved by other stories. And we've talked about this before in previous episodes. Now, there are many ways to create resonance in your writing, and we'll explore this throughout the season. Now, I chose this movie to kick off my study of resonance because, like I mentioned, it has such a smorgasbord of elements to choose from. So here are some of the genre elements that the Lego Batman movie uses. And I'm going to list those out, but I've also picked some of the older stories to link it through to the genre to show how Lego Batman has drawn from them, or to give you a sense of how far back some of the conventions that we expect go in literary history, I suppose. So we have The Man in Black, So I've referred to this in last week's episode, which is a nice coincidence, I think. We also have the vigilante story, which, you know, if we think about it, Robin Hood is a good example of the vigilante. We have sidekicks. So we have Sherlock Holmes and Watson with Batman and Robin. We obviously have superhero stories, and comic books are really good references for the conventions that we expect in superhero stories. We also have a hero with a secret identity, and the Scarlet Pimpernel is a really good example of when this first came into popular fiction. We have villains and minions, and just to list a few, we have Sauron, Daleks, King Kong, Gremlins, Medusa, Godzilla, Velociraptors. You know, these are all in the movie and are thematic and types of stories as well. And of course, we have good versus evil. And, you know, a prime example of that would be the Bible. Now, Batman stories have been retold many times. And I mentioned the comics before, but there's also been screen versions, which are all referenced by Alfred in Lego Batman. The skins of the characters in this movie are taken from various iterations of the Batman franchise, and if you've been watching them, you'll recognize them in the movie. Batman has been reincarnated so many times that it even has its own conventions, such as Gotham City, the multitude of bat vehicles, the utility belt, and of course the villains like the Penguin, the Joker, and Catwoman. And of course, there's Robin and Alfred as well, because it would not be Batman if Robin and Alfred weren't there too. So the Lego Batman character was first brought to life in the Lego DC superhero movie, but it was the 2014 Lego movie that delivered us Will Arnett's version, which we see in this movie that we're analysing. Now, the Lego movie also introduced us to the idea of the master builder, and Batman is a master builder. Now, master builders, in case you don't know, have the ability to build anything out of bricks without using the instructions. Batman uses this newer Lego movie convention in Lego Batman, and we see him do this at Commissioner Gordon's retirement party. But it's also used to show part of Batman's transition from a vigilante, a lone vigilante, to a team player when he starts to teach Robin how to be a master builder when they visit Superman's fortress. So it's this internal shift, or the hero's journey, which Valerie has discussed in many episodes, which is key to the thematic resonance within the story. So it has external and internal resonance. It has links to other stories, but repetition of scene types drive home what the story is really about. And this is where the resonance type called emotional need comes into storytelling. Now, I want to draw out the comic vigilante story in the Lego Batman movie and its conventions. Now, a vigilante is involved in the act of enforcement, investigation, or punishment of perceived offences without legal authority. And vigilantes can be good or bad depending on the type of story you'd like to tell. Now, vigilantes are usually driven by some sort of sense of moral injustice, and Batman, in his origin story, swears vengeance on all criminals after witnessing the murder of his parents in Gotham City. Vigilantes usually work outside of the law, so Batman actually works to help conventional police services in Gotham City, as evidenced by the bat phone and the bat signal. But in this movie, we see Barbara trying to get Batman to work within the law, something that Batman resists at all costs. You know, vigilantes are hunters. They hunt down those who they believe are the source of or represent the forces that they are trying to fight, and they mostly work alone. Now, this is where the external expectations of Lego Batman start to cross over into the theme of the story. We see the repetition of the Batman works alone idea throughout the movie, And it's repeated in dialogue, it's repeated in his actions, and it's used in the major turning points of the story as well. In fact, it's Phyllis from the Phantom Zone who says to Batman, after she scanned him, and I quote, "You can't be a hero if you only care about yourself. You're not a traditional bad guy, but you're not a good guy," end quote. And this is the fundamental human truth the Batman movie taps into. The theme, "We are better if we work as a team," has been repeated throughout time, and it will continue to be repeated in future stories in different iterations and versions as well. Now, Batman's transition is laid out for us right at the beginning of the movie when he quotes Michael Jackson's Man in the Mirror. This song is also sung or at various places in the movie, and we also hear small parts of the riff as well. And this is how internal resonance around the themes of loneliness and family work in Lego Batman. Now, I'm going to list out how, particularly the first part of the movie, the themes or the points of the story that repeat but focus on family and loneliness. So we see Batman fighting Joker, and he refuses to recognize the symbiotic relationship that he has with Joker. He lets the Joker go so he can save Gotham City, and then he's adored by the population, but he still goes home alone. He eats alone, he watches movies alone, and he stares at photos of his mother and father alone. Alfred tells him that it's time to face his greatest fear, and that is being part of a family again. And when Alfred says that, Batman has a bit of a tanty. Bruce Wayne, so also Batman, goes to the Commissioner Gordon's retirement party. When he's distracted, he agrees to adopt Dick Grayson, one of the boys from the local orphanage. Now, the Joker and Batman fight at the party. Batman stomps on Barbara, who is trying to work with Batman. The Joker removes himself from Batman's life, and Batman is lonelier than he's ever been. And we hear and see this with the use of the song, "One is the Loneliest Number That You'll Ever Do." Now, Alfred acts like a parent and tells Batman to raise his son, which is Dick Grayson. So Batman at this point is no longer alone, but he refuses to acknowledge any need or connection to Robin, or Alfred for that matter. Now, this continues on, so his denial continues on until it's clear that Batman, Robin, Babs and Alfred make a great team. But Batman's fear of losing his new family causes him to double down on being alone, and he sends them away. So we can see how the internal resonance is a repeat of similar types of scenes, but with an escalation of stakes as the story progresses. Joker shows Batman that every good hero needs a villain. Robin shows Batman that he could have a son. Alfred is Batman's father figure, and Babs is representative of teamwork. Now, Lego Batman is a movie that packs a lot of resonance in 1 hour and 44 minutes. And I'm actually living proof that resonance works in this movie. I love Lego. My granddad gave me my first Lego set when I was 8, and he gave my brother his first Lego set when he was 7. And we played with space Lego for hours and hours as children. So watching Lego movies brings back those feelings for me, and I've also imparted a love of Lego in my children. We have boxes and boxes of it in our house, and that alone is a testament to the power of resonance in a Lego movie, let alone a Batman movie that includes all the great literary and movie villains of the 20th century. Resonance is the most powerful tool you can use to create stories your readers will love. And there's so much more I could say about this movie, but I'd like to know what you thought about it, Valerie.
Yeah, we had Lego growing up as a kid too, and I do love them, except when I step on them in my sock feet. Then I'm not a great fan. And my son is 23 now. He's about to turn 24. And if he had been the the age, the target age for this this movie. This movie would have been playing in my house a lot, and I would have had to buy all that Lego. All right. This season, I'm talking about plot structure. So that's arc plot, mini plot, anti-plot, all that kind of stuff. Lego Batman's arc plot. Surprise, surprise, surprise. And it's a terrific lesson for us all in the importance of understanding our genre. I just want to say that first, because this movie knows exactly what it is, and it does it really well. It's mostly action sequences, but the story continues through those action sequences. Now, contrast this to some of the other action stories we've studied on the show so far. And I'm thinking of Dune, Star Wars, Skyfall, and I'm sure there are others. And in those movies, the film is mostly spectacle. There's tons of action sequences, but the storytelling stops while the action sequences happen. In Lego Batman, that's not the case. The story is continuing through the action sequences. And I thought that was really interesting. I was fascinated to see how they did that. Children's movies tend to be shorter than adult movies because children's attention span is shorter, typically. However, honestly, I think that adults right now have a very short attention span as well. So really, no matter who you're writing for, adults or kids, there's no time to waste. You got to get into the story. You got to keep it moving. Now, the other thing to keep in mind here is that often action stories don't have any internal genre. And by that, I mean that the main character is the same at the end of the story as he was at the beginning. But in Lego Batman, the creators are actually using the action sequences to help develop Batman's inner journey. Yeah, of course it's on the nose. Of course it is. But this is a kid's movie, and kids don't have the same experience with stories or with the world that we do. So the storytelling is bolder. Now, that said, there's still plenty of jokes in there for the parents. They have not forgotten the parents. like all the previous incarnations of Batman, which I thought was pretty funny. The ninth ab, that was pretty funny. And in terms of the plot structure, which is what I'm studying this season, there's no doubt that the structure of the story is an arc plot structure, and it's solid, rock solid. If you're new to the hero's journey, this is a good film to study because the stages of the hero's journey and the archetypes are very clearly drawn and easy to see. It's therefore also a prime example of the arc plot story as outlined in Robert McKee's story. And that's one of my main references this season. I went over this in the what makes an arc plot story. I went over this in great detail last week in Men in Black, but let me go through them quickly here again. First, there's clear causality. For example, Richard Grayson, or Dick Grayson, shows up at Wayne Manor because he believed that Bruce Wayne had adopted him. Now, why did he believe that? Because of the previous scene at Commissioner Gordon's retirement gala. And there, Dick, who is a child, he's an orphan, he reveres both Bruce Wayne and Batman. He's asking Bruce for advice and guidance. His questions are in earnest. He's innocent, and he believes that Bruce is giving him genuine answers to his genuine questions. He doesn't understand that Bruce is trying to brush him off. So because of what happened at Commissioner Gordon's retirement gala, that's the cause. The effect is that Richard Grayson, Dick Grayson, Robin, whatever you want to call him, shows up at Wayne Manor. So that's clear causality, a cause and effect statement. One thing happens because another thing happened. Arc plot stories also have a closed ending. And honestly, Lego Batman, the ending here is about as closed as it can possibly be. They even lean into that and play it up. This whole business of a closed ending. And this is with the snake clowns at the end. You've got Batman's voiceover saying, quote, "All important movies end with a white screen and tying up loose ends like this snake clowns bit." The tying up all the loose ends, that's what you have in a closed ending. It's not always as neat and tidy as it is here in Batman. I just have to emphasize that. But this is a, as bold an example as you're ever going to find. The next point is linear time, and yes, this story runs chronologically with no flashbacks. But there is a photograph of Bruce's parents standing at Crime Alley, which I thought was funny, which is a memory. So it's not a flashback, but it's a memory suggesting Bruce's backstory for anyone who doesn't know. And the children might not know. And there are several references to previous Batman movies and the shows, which Melanie is resonance, right? And all of that suggests Batman's memories, but it doesn't interfere with the linear timeline of the story. So that was kind of a nice touch. External conflict? Yep, sure is. Lots of it. Like I said, this film is mostly action sequences, but they do a good job of highlighting Bruce's inner conflict. Again, it's mostly with on-the-nose dialogue and visuals like the family photograph. And why? Because this is a kid's movie. I feel like I'm a broken record already. Another component of the arc plot story is a single active protagonist, and this is obviously Batman. And finally, a consistent reality. Now, here we're talking about the reality of the story, not the reality of our actual world. I talked about this last week, but I really want to emphasize it again because it is that important. We can set our stories in any kind of fictional world we want. We can create whatever rules we want, and the reader will go with us. But we have got to stick with those rules that we've created. We cannot break them. Why? Well, the reader is going to notice if we break them, and they will cry foul. And nothing gets a reader to put a book down faster than when we break the rules that we set. Now, Robert McKee suggests that writers master the arc plot form first before moving on to any of the other forms. And he's not saying this arbitrarily. There's real logic and wisdom here. There are a whole lot of novelists and memoirists who say that they don't care if they ever sell a copy of their book because they think that somehow the desire to actually earn a living is arrogant, or they think that if they want a book to be commercially viable, like that's somehow vulgar or somehow devalues the art or robs them of their artistry. But they do want to finish their book and they want to publish it and they want to see it on the shelf in their local bookstore. Now to do that, they need an agent and a publisher. And I guarantee you that that agent and that publisher, as much as they love literature, they want to see a profit because stories are their livelihood. This is going to be harsh, not meant to be harsh. It is true. The agents, the publishers, the booksellers, they're not here to help you and me check off an item on our bucket lists. They're just not. And the reason I say that is not to be cruel or unkind. It's because I think it's really important that we all understand the industry that we're getting ourselves into so that we can make the best possible choices for our careers or whatever goal it is we have for ourselves. Now, in saying this, I also know that of those writers who claim not to care whether their books sell any copies, they're the same people who have dreams of being number one on the New York Times bestseller list. And if that's a goal of yours, great goal. I applaud you for having a goal. Absolutely. But to get there, you got to sell a whole lot of copies in 1 week. So why does McKee say that we need to master the arc plot story first? And keep in mind that Robert McKee is a man who has dedicated his entire adult life to studying and thinking very deeply about stories and storytelling and how stories affect our lives. He knows more about this than we do. He has much deeper insight, so I don't know about anybody else, but I think I'd be pretty foolish to discount it. Now, I want to read a few quotes for you from Story, and it comes from pages 62 to 66. They're just a few lines I've pulled out that I think are particularly interesting. And McKee says, quote, "As story design moves away from the arc plot and down the triangle toward the far reaches of mini-plot, anti-plot, and non-plot, the audience shrinks." And of course, the triangle he's referring to here is his concept of the story triangle, and that's what I'm studying all season. He also says that most human beings, and this is important, most human beings believe that life brings closed experiences of absolute irreversible change, that their greatest sources of conflict are external to themselves, that they are the single and active protagonists of their own existence, that their existence operates through continuous time with a consistent, causally interconnected reality, and that inside this reality, events happen for explainable and meaningful reasons. Classical design, which is another way he describes the arc plot story, displays the temporal, spatial, and causal patterns of human perception, outside of which the mind rebels. And McKee also points out that classical design is in fact not a Western view of life. This is really important information for us to have. So again, further to McKee, when the audience senses that a story is drifting too close to fictional realities it finds tedious or meaningless, it feels alienated and turns away. This is true of intelligent, sensitive people of all incomes and backgrounds. The vast majority of human beings cannot endorse the inconsistent realities of anti-plot, the internalized passivity of mini-plot, and the static circularity of non-plot as metaphors for the life they live. And doesn't this tie in to exactly what Lisa Cron says in Wired for Story that I talked about way, way, way back in the first season? And I'll remind you, what she says is that we are, quote, wired to turn to story to teach us the way of the world. So the world in the story has to mimic somehow reality for us to metabolize it and make sense of it. And it's the arc plot structure that allows us writers to do that. Because when we get into mini plot, anti plot, all that kind of stuff, it starts to get away from a form of story that mirrors or that mimics, I guess is a better word, the real world that we live in. Okay, back to McKee again. I'm not finished yet. McKee says that great storytellers have always known that, regardless of background or education, everyone, consciously or instinctively, enters the story ritual with classical anticipation. And this is what I always say, right? In other words, the arc plot structure is what we think of when we think of story. Therefore, says McKee, to make mini-plot and anti-plot work, the writer must play with or against this expectancy. Only by carefully and creatively shattering or bending classical form can the artist lead the audience to perceive the inner life hidden in a mini plot or to accept the chilling absurdity of an anti plot. That's really important. And finally, one of my all-time favorite quotes. This is McKee's bluntness here. He says, "Don't kid yourself that you understand arc plot because you've seen it in the movies. You'll know you understand it when you can do it. The writer works at his skills until knowledge shifts from the left side of the brain to the right, until intellectual awareness becomes living craft." So here on the Story Nerd podcast, this is all left-brained work that we're doing. We're understanding the theory on an intellectual level, and we're observing how other writers have used it in their stories. That's all left brain. The right brain work is in the creation of our own stories. And this is what happens when we sit down to write our books. And we need both the left brain and the right brain. We need it to understand the theory, but we also need to know how to execute the theory. As an editor, that's what I do best. I help writers put story theory into practice. That's my niche. That's what I'm doing when I'm working one-on-one with clients. Now, I love that all of you are here with us on the podcast, and I love that you're telling your friends about us, and I love, 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 love the ratings and reviews. So, mwah! But please know that listening to the show is only half the job. It's the left-brained half. To truly see an improvement in your writing, you got to start taking the ideas from the show and use them in your own work. That's why every week, Melanie and I start the podcast with this. If you want to write stories your readers will love, there are three things you have to do. Understand storytelling principles, see how other writers have applied those principles, and then use them in your own work. Here on the Story Nerd podcast, our goal is to demystify story theory. We'll help you with the first two steps so that you can get started with the third. That's the marriage of the left and the right brain. So, if you're writing a nonlinear story with multiple protagonists, but you haven't yet mastered the arc plot form, you may be setting yourself up for failure. You're most definitely making the process much harder than it needs to be. Now, I'm not telling you not to do that. I mean, if that's the story that is in your heart, then go for it. Just understand what it is you're doing. What is it McKee said? Everyone enters the story ritual with classical anticipation, which is they expect an arc plot story. When they think about story, they think of an arc plot story. So, to make mini plot and anti plot work, the writer must play with or against this expectancy. Only by carefully and creatively shattering or bending classical form can the artist lead the audience to perceive the inner life hidden in a mini plot or to accept the chilling absurdity of an anti plot. So, in other words, to pull off a nonlinear and/or multi protagonist story, you have to know how to bend and shape a linear single protagonist story. And if you can't already write a damn good linear single protagonist story, then instead of starting at step one and going to step two, what you're doing is starting at step one and jumping to step 50 without any knowledge of what's in between. And since each step builds on the one before it, jumping directly to step 50 is really hard. It is. So if your brain feels like it's melting sometimes, it probably is. And this is why we end every episode with the phrase, take it one step at a time. So all of this to say, if you truly do want to see an improvement in your writing, make sure you're using the theory. Put it into practice. Now, you don't have to take all of the ideas that Melanie and I talk about and use them all at once. Just latch on to one idea at a time and get that one idea working. If you do that, your writing will improve. Come on, you can do it. I know you can. I know you can. And Melanie, you and I can do it too. And speaking of taking an idea and putting it into action, how's this for a segue? Melanie, what do you have for today's action step?
Do you know, can I just add before I go on to that, is that, you know, arc plot stories repeated and repeated and evolved into, I think, what has become mini plot and anti-plot stories. So again, there's a level of resonance right throughout time that we can see iteratively changing things and morphing them to become something new. Anyway, I was just thinking that while you were speaking, and you can see how powerful that resonance is and that drawing from things that have gone before. And that's why I think it's such a fascinating area to study, but one that's really not written about at all. All right, on to the action step. So this week, I want you to familiarize yourself with the best-selling books in your chosen genre. Have you read them? And if so, start pulling those books apart and really study them. Study everything from the cover to the black blurb. Know what makes those books tick. If you haven't read the best-selling books in your chosen genre, well, you have some work to do.
And that wraps it up for this week. Join us again next week when we discuss The Accidental Tourist. To support the show, please leave us a rating and review and tell your writer friends about us. For access to writing templates and worksheets and more than 70 hours of training, subscribe to My Inner Circle by visiting valeriefrancis.ca/innercircle and follow me on Twitter and Instagram at @Valerie_Francis. If you'd like to find out about books to help you read like a writer, visit Melanie on Facebook and Instagram under Melanie Hill Author, or find out more about her at melaniehill.com.au. And remember, story theory doesn't have to be difficult. It's a tool to help you write more, not less. So take it one step at a time, remember, and have fun.